At the outset, let me tell you that I am privileged to be invited as chief guest for this very distinguished university. Last month I was sharing a field visit, along with your vice chancellor, and I was all praised for this university, which has come up in a very short notice, and I'm sure they will make many more strides in the field of management and other fields. I did not want our colleague to present more about myself because I thought I'll tell you and then tell you the background why probably I was called here. Currently, I'm sitting on the board of a bank, a public sector bank. I have not done finance as a specialization or a subject of study, but I have dealt and dabbled with finance. And every day I'm doing that now. And in the last 2-3 years, I have developed an interest, and I initially somebody introduced that I am also interested in corporate strategy. And for the last 4-5 years, in fact, a couple of us were always predicting that this bubble is going to burst. You may call it, coming to the topic as such, you may call it pessimism, or you may call it foresight, or you may call it hindsight, or you may call it whatever it is. But the simple phenomena in life, because when you're talking about global financial meltdown, myth or reality, we are seeing every today. And this, I think many academics in management and commerce were feeling for the last 4 years. Only thing is, nobody thought about that it would happen so quickly, so much it would impact, and probably nobody can ever expect that this kind of a meltdown. Before I go into the reasons, I wanted to make a presentation. In fact, my presentation was ready, but I thought having come late, I should not take my, but I will definitely dwell on some of the points which we definitely have been looking at. Number one, the most, because we are talking about reality or myth, the reality in life or in business or for anything, like in marketing, we say customer lifetime value. You are a student today, I find young students today, you will become an executive tomorrow. Once you become an executive, you will become a CEO. Once you become a CEO, you will gain a lot of experience, you will make up a lot. But over the years, you are actually going to your peak and coming down. This is the fact of life. Whether it is business, whether it is a customer, whether it is a teacher, whether it is a whatever it is. But little did the world realize that these are only peaks. And we were totally dependent on one sector, including country like India. In 1999, I still remember when we started the School of Management Studies, one of the arguments I proposed was, why should we depend totally on the service sector? Because you are only serving other. If that sector is gone, your core industry, which is agriculture and manufacturing, goes down. So the beginning was too much insistence on one particular sector, that is a service sector throughout the world. Because jobs are there, they are easy to get, and the requirement was there. So if you trace in the last 10 years what happened, this is very common. What you are talking today is very common, but it is not common to find such a depth of its impact, because it happens, some mid-course correction takes place, and people come back to normals. But what happened was, because of the excessive capital infusion into the market, by way of providing loans, credit, cheaper credit, etc., many developed countries gave money which the borrower or the prospect or the customer could not pay back, number one. Number two, the inflationary trends were not really looked at in a proper perspective. For example, the growth in real estate, growth in many other sectors we talk about, the banking industry, the money was available, but a proper judicious due diligence was not followed. For example, I'll just quote an example. Since I am sitting on the board of a bank today, just 2 days back we had a meeting, and some of them said, no, don't fund real estate. Don't fund hospitality projects. Don't fund service. But I had a different viewpoint. I said, no. In these times of recession, you get the best bargain. In fact, you can reduce your exposure to the sector. For example, you can tell them to give more upfront payment. I'm sure most of you are, at least the broad contours of the subject. So what I'm trying to say is people try to think that this bubble or the temporary phase which we saw all over the world would continue, number one. Number two, overpricing of services. You see, if you take the IT industry as such, the transfer pricing, we call it. Most of you, if you are from commerce, you will know better. The transfer pricing of services. And everything was dependent on one single currency, that is a dollar. So I will trace back the reasons. One of the reasons was over-dependence on certain sectors. Too much dependence on the one single economy or probably couple of countries which got the most of the services. So it is automatic. There is a backlash somewhere and you will have an impact here. Would you have ever believed that, and somebody was telling me last week, Nobel Prize, the ILO, the person who had R.K. Pachuri, the group which got the Nobel Prize, he was on our campus and he was saying that nobody expected a $140 barrel of oil to come down to 36. So in the world economy, and everybody thought that the oil is going to be very expensive, suddenly it crashed. So point I'm trying to say, I'm trying to build a relationship, is easy credit availability. There are no, what do you call, barriers for borrowing. Normally in a good economy, sound economy, you have very strong barriers for borrowing. For example, what is the biggest problem which is going to again happen next 1 or 2 months in the United States? Lot of credit, people are not going to honor that credit. People, there is no market for real estate. Credit card holders, everybody, whether they were credit worthy or not, they were given credit cards, easy loans, 5%, 5.5%. And today what will happen? The repayment capacity has gone. Nobody is able to pay that kind of money. So similarly, if you go to Europe, if you go to probably one of the economies which not, the Asia Pacific has not been touched yet, though they say that the impact will be very high but slow. But the reality is that it will definitely have an impact on countries like India, Bangladesh, China, Pakistan, all the economies which were dependent on many other things. For example, yesterday I was reading the textile production for which Bangladesh has got a number one. In fact, it has reached a very enviable position. The textile industry has moved to Bangladesh. They are also not able to cope with this recession because the order book is reduced. So unrealistic demand projections, unrealistic salary expectations, unrealistic credit infusion into the marketplace, and low or no controls over borrowings in LDCs, less developed economies. I can understand a very solid established nations, for example, United States or Europe. If I borrow 1 lakh rupees and jump and I don't pay the loan, no bank will give me loan because there is an exchange of data. There is a borrower's history which is shared. But in countries like India, where the financial system itself is very, very weak, the backbone of the financial system is proper record keeping and proper controls. Of course, the RBI has done a wonderful job, but tell me today, all the related problems of borrowing, over-borrowing, and lot of losses for the banks, and today there is what we are doing is a knee-jerk reaction. That means we have not thought about it. Our planning was very, very poor in trying to look at it. All of us only did one thing, the software mantra. Everybody thought software is going to. Who are the stakeholders in this? The government, policymakers, students, parents, people like us, academicians. We never really looked at how could a person with low or no skills get 30,000 rupees? If you just talk in good English, does it mean that it is going to fetch you a job for life? But whereas countries like China, I must really appreciate, though they say China is an open economy with a closed mind, and India is a closed economy with a, or something like that. Oh, sorry, it's the other way around. What they have done, they have looked at this problem, where the population is the biggest, that's number one. And like C.K. Prahlad said, India or China, all these populous countries in our continent, it's not a problem, it is an advantage. What they have done, they have taken to manufacturing. Today, wherever you go, in Japan, in USA, in Korea, in Europe, if you pick up anything, pen to aeroplane, you will find made in China. They have made this as a kind of a brand China. Everywhere, toys, dresses, shoe, So what did they do? They strengthened their manufacturing sector. In India, what we did, unfortunately, we were losing out on the manufacturing sector. In the craze to go for more service sector, we have lost out our opportunities. The agriculture sector, C.K. Prahlad said, India has 1 billion hands, 1 billion people. So that means 2 billion hands. Out of 2 billion hands, let us take 60% are people who can make, leave aside the children, old age, pensioners, etc. You could do wonders. You could produce for domestic consumption. Unfortunately, that has not happened. So if you look at the impacts of this, sir, I think I have five minutes or so maximum. Then another, guesstimate or people are saying that when all this crashes, you know, I'm not a finance person, but I know a little bit of it, which says that if the stock market goes down, the bullion market goes. If the bullion market goes down, the commodities market goes. I mean, some, I don't know what formula it works, but oil prices go up and all. There are four or five realities and four or five myths in the whole thing. I wanted to concentrate and my whole presentation, I thought I'll get you the realities and myth statement. I'll read it and then so that I'll not take much time on that. So the myth, first reality, myth was that all stock markets function on a very scientific basis. Stock markets are manned by people like you and me who know as much as the other person or don't know as much as the other person. There was an experiment in one business school where what they did, they gave fresh MBA graduates $100,000 each and said, you go and play in the financial market. You do whatever you want. And they came back after 1 month and can you believe they earned more than the biggest stock market player who is a very experienced stock player. So it is like guess, it is like tossing a coin. So what I mean to say is that it's a very incorrect how much research you have done, how much of plan. Lehman Brothers, for example. Did anybody think that Lehman Brothers could crash like this? No. So the myth is Wall Street is nothing but a giant casino. Myth or reality, you call it. The contemporary financial markets are characterized by risk aversion. And what the reality is that, for example, Morgan Stanley, I still remember, sir, I'm sure you must have also read or seen about it. Around 15 years back, people in India queued up to buy Morgan Stanley shares. I'm sure some of you friends will remember. Today, the stock has not gone up anything. 15 years, they have taken up the money from the shareholders. It's a multinational company with lot of top executives working at fat salaries. So the faith in the finance market itself is getting eroded. Two, unrealistic valuation of real estate prices, second aspect, and that's a reality. Three, realities are concealed, economic statistics are manipulated, and economic concepts are turned upside down by many so-called strategic planners to suit the needs of the companies. You have seen, I do not want to say the recent example. Somebody asked, why does Warren Buffett does not lose in the stock market? In the seminar we had last week, and somebody said, Warren Buffett does not lose market in the stock market because, any answer from the students? He invests when people are losing, and he buys when the people are losing, and he sells when people are greedy. So he does not, and he has a control on his acquisitions or financial dealings. So I think as we are going back into this whole thing, it's the right thing that they have done. It's a very timely, contemporary topic. But as young students, and I'm sure most of us who are also into many other activities, what are the three key lessons we take from this? Somebody said the same companies which work 5 days a week, which had all the coupons, car pickups, and you know, J-class travel and boardroom luxuries, today they are all cutting down in the name of recession. So what does it teach us? If you go back to any philosophy, the kid doesn't eat is beta khana kala, have food, otherwise the Indians and Chinese are going to come. Really, this was the This was a story which Friedman wrote. Means they are hardworking, they are intelligent, or whatever it is. Now, what is the lesson for India? Beta, theek se kaam karo. So you will not be there in the world market at all. Because we are dependent on something else, some other economy. So what are the key takeaways from this whole exercise, or conclusion, is that we must think ahead to ensure the development of sustainable solutions. What is happening in this conspicuous consumption economy? All of us want to have more and more of things which actually we need less and less. Isn't it? Do you agree with me? I'm sure the youngsters will not agree. I'm sure some of you who are middle-aged, they'll definitely agree. We want to have more and more conspicuous consumption. There's a paradigm shift. There's no insistence on savings. There's no insistence on long-term solutions to anything. Everything is a pizza kind of an approach, a packaged approach. Things should be over in a jiffy. I should rise in my career. I should earn in my career. So let us look at just some responses and see how throughout the world we have failed in meeting this myth, meeting this reality. Not only India. First, on September 15th, China cut the interest rates for the first time since 2002. Indonesia reduced its overnight repo rate, of which commercial banks can borrow overnight funds. Reserve Bank of Australia injected nearly $1.5 billion stimulus package into the banking system, nearly three times as much as market estimate requirements. Reserve Bank of India added almost $1.32 billion through a refinance operation, its biggest in at least a month. On November 9th, 2008, the Chinese economy, they announced a stimulus plan. So coming back to impact on education, and finally, that is what I think all of us are here and what we can do. The global financial crisis is an added advantage to countries, to developing economies in this part of the world. The reason is, during recession, everybody wants to go to school. There is a famous saying, when the economy is not doing good, education will do very good. People will try to hone up their skills, learn more, SAP, ABAP, something else, or some whatever is the new. So what is the lesson for us? The lesson for countries in this part of the world, which are less endowed but more safer, because our domestic consumption is quite high. Do you know, I was really surprised and really amazed some time back to know that things like shampoo, things like day-to-day commodities which we use are still imported. In an economy which is having so many people underemployed, which can be made employed. For example, if you go to a Chinese family, a small family, the lady of the house works, the son works, the daughter works. By evening, they'll make some 10 toys, go to the market and sell it, and then come back. Here, what is happening is the dignity of labor, that we should become a manufacturing economy. Peter Drucker once said, India can be the supplier for the globe, or for that matter, any developing economy. So the reason is, why I'm saying about education, is Indian education, or many countries, what we can do is we can start programs which are very low cost, but not low in value. And we can actually become the educational providers for the globe. For example, universities like MANUU, universities like University of Hyderabad, we are all known in the global arena. Now, what is the opportunity, I say, ahead? Teachers like us, Dr. Azim, we can start programs which are low cost but highly effective. Because in the United States, anything you want to say, you will have, or in Germany, Japan, they are all high priced tickets, whereas we can put low ticket. And what are the courses we can do? We can empower people through small value addition, skill addition. The 11th plan says the skill addition is a major task, and they have earmarked a lot of money. In fact, in the words of Prime Minister Manmohan Singh, the 11th plan is an education budget. The 11th plan is a skill development budget. So mind you, my dear friends, the opportunity is really great. I am talking with a lot of conviction, because today there are no people who have begun to become entrepreneurs. Everybody wants to become businessmen. And what will happen if everybody gets into business? Because you don't know the science of business. You just want to trade around in the stock market. You just want to think that everything is going to be permanent. But it is not. One has to have a critical set of skills to market, to perform, and to excel. And in the words of Dr. Abdul Kalam, what we need to do is we need to create more job creators than job seekers. Unfortunately, I'll end with I'll request the Pro Vice Chancellor to permit me. Today, many youngsters and many institutions are not realizing that unless we develop skills, attitudes, that is called, you know, very interesting, cash. You know what is cash? Knowledge, attitude, skills, and habits. Cash hota. Okay? Thank you very much.